morning and welcome. You're all welcome, whether you are a regular attender or a newcomer, whether you're here with us in person or joining us on Zoom this morning, or even watching later. Whatever you bring in your heart, whether you come in sadness or joy or out of sheer curiosity, whatever your faith or none, you are welcome. I hope you enjoyed our opening music. It was a piece called River Flows In You by Yirumi, and we thought it was appropriate for the theme of our service today. Our theme is We Are Nature, and it's offered by our church green team. This Thursday, the 30th of November, COP28, the 28th annual United Nations climate meeting, opens in Dubai, and it runs until the 12th of December. COP, stands for Conference of the Parties, where the parties are the countries which signed up to the original UN climate agreement back in 1992, over 30 years ago. Governments will be discussing how to limit and prepare for future climate change. And these meetings will surely involve much serious debate. For this is a serious subject, affecting not only we human beings, but every living being on our planet. The only planet where we know for sure that life in all its rich and incredible diversity exists. This is something to be celebrated. We don't know how much celebration there will be at COP28. So this morning, we are celebrating all the richness, abundance, and interconnectedness of life. Call it nature, if you like. And we humans are part of nature and should not forget that. So we're going to celebrate in song and story, poetry and prayer. And we offer our service to you with our love. First, we'll start, as is our custom, by lighting our chalice flame as a symbol of our free religious faith. And if you're at home and have a candle, you may like to light it now. And Marian, would you like to come up and light the flame for us?
Litany of Celebration by the Reverend Cliff Reed. We celebrate the essential unity of the world. May there be an end to systems of distrust and enmity. We celebrate the glorious diversity of the human species. May there be an end to injustice and prejudice. We celebrate the web of life enfolding this good earth. May there be an end to all that destroys our global home. We celebrate and give thanks for the resources of our planet. May we put an end to hunger, poverty, and wasteful husbandry. We celebrate the divine spirit at work within us and sustaining our one world. May the one world vision be ours. May we celebrate our unity here together. May what is true for us now be true for more and more people everywhere, until the whole world knows that it is one.
Thank you, Marian, for lighting our chalice and for reading those wonderful words. So I invite you to join in singing our first hymn this morning, which is from the Green Book, 280, Morning Has Broken, but the words should appear on the screen as well. Let us turn now to a time of prayer and reflection. And let us pause and hold in our thoughts and our prayers those within this church community and their loved ones, all in our city, all in the wider world, especially anyone who's experiencing sadness or worry or difficult times, whatever the reasons. Let's hold in our thoughts and prayers all those whose lives have been lost or changed for whatever reasons, especially though due to violence because of political and social unrest, natural disasters, or plain misfortune. And we think again, especially of the continued conflicts in Ukraine and in Gaza, although there are many throughout the world, unfortunately. May all fleeing conflict, most of them vulnerable, the young, the sick, the women, the elderly, may they find sanctuary somewhere and peace. And may the places to which they flee somehow find the strength and resources to provide what is needed. May those claiming to be the leaders of all countries be blessed with compassion and wisdom to prevent further destruction, both of human lives and of the wider environment. And wherever there are fragile signs of a more peaceful future, may they flourish and prosper. As we pause just for a moment in the quietness of our own thoughts, let's consider the blessings and the trials of our own lives. And may we dedicate ourselves to sharing our blessings and to doing what we can to ease the trials of others. So, just a pause for a moment. Amen. And a prayer called Our Best Expectations. And this is by somebody called Mary O'Cleary, who I think is an American Unitarian Universalist. Knowing that we do not always live up to our best expectations of ourselves, let us seek the good within, which some call the inner light, and some a spark of the divine. Knowing we live in a society that falls far short of the ideal, let us, for a moment, think of one thing we could do this week to aid those who are not as well off as we are. Knowing that the earth is our home and that humankind is often making it a dirty and even unsafe one, let us in quietness consider just for a moment how we might be a part of making it more healthy for all living beings. Knowing that each one of us has some sorrow or worry hidden within, let us consider in quietness how we may reach out to one another with a smile, a hand clasp, an encouraging word. Amen. All the readings this morning have been chosen by members of the Green Team. For those of you that aren't aware, our minister, Reverend Kate, was instrumental in setting this up not long after she'd come here. We've been going for over 7 years. So Kate is a member, and although she can't be with us today, she has written a short piece, which I'll read later on. She's also suggested one or two short readings. So there's Kate, there's Marion, there's Delphine, there's Edgar, Anne was a member for a while, and Erna Colebrook, who now lives away up with her daughter. But whenever she gets in touch with me, she always asks what we're doing. And then there's me. So all our readings today are offered or contributed by members of the Green Team. And Marion is going to read the first of them.
This is Nature. It's called Nature by Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. Hope I've pronounced that right. Nature. We are surrounded and empowered by her, powerless to separate ourselves from her, and powerless to penetrate beyond her. She has always thought and always thinks, though not as man, but as nature. She causes an endless succession of new capacities for enjoyment to spring up, that her insatiable sympathy may be assuaged. The spectacle of nature is always new, for she is always renewing the spectators. Life is her most exquisite invention, and death is her expert contrivance to get plenty of life.
Thank you, Mary. And now Delphine is going to read the first of her pieces. So if you'd like to come up to the lectern, Delphine.
Hello, everybody. I've got to speak up. I'm going to present to you a reading from this little book. It's teeny, it's tiny. It's called Green Ideas. It's by a woman called Robin Lee Kimmerer. She was a woman of the Potawatomi tribe nation in America, a First Nation tribe. And her attempt to come back to her heritage was through meeting up with the last nine living speakers of the language at a conference, and then determining to learn that language for herself. And what she found surprised her a lot. She talks about the grammar of animacy. Grammar is kind of dull and boring, but actually it expresses relationships. Grammar is the relationships that are apparent in our lives. Animacy comes from animated life. It's a Latin word, life that's born. So the grammar of animacy shows how the relationships of the living work. Imagine seeing your grandmother standing at the stove in her apron and then saying of her, "Look, it is making soup. It has grey hair." We might snigger at such a mistake, but we also recoil from it. In English, we never refer to a member of our family, or indeed to any person, as it. That would be a profound act of disrespect. It robs a person of selfhood and kinship, reducing a person to a mere thing. So it is that in Potawatomi and almost all other indigenous languages in America, we use the same words to address the living word as we use for our family, because they are our family. To whom does our language extend the grammar of animacy? Naturally, plants, animals are animate. But as I learn and I'm discovering, Potawatomi understanding of it means to be animate diverges from the list of attributes of beings that we learnt about in biology class. In Potawatomi biology, rocks are animate, as are mountains and water and fire and places. Beings that are imbued with spirit or anima. Our innate sacred medicines, our songs, our drums, our even stories are all animate, living. The list of inanimate objects seems smaller, filled with objects made by people. Of an inanimate being like a table, we say, "What is it?" And we answer, "Dopwen yewe," table, it is. But of an apple, we must say, "Who is that being?" And reply, "Mshimin yawe," apple, that being is. Yawe, the living animate to be, I am, you are, she is, he is. To speak of those possessed with life and spirit, we must say Yahweh. By what linguistic confluence do Yahweh of the Old Testament and Yahweh of the New World both fall from the mouths of the reverent? Isn't this just what it means to be, to have the breath of life within us, to be the offspring of creation? The language reminds us in every sentence of our kinship with all of the animate world. So the grammar reflects our relationships, and maybe a grammar of animacy could lead us to a whole new ways of living in a world where other species are a sovereign people, a world with a democracy of species, the democracy of species, a democracy of species, not a tyranny of one, and we have a moral responsibility to water and wolves, and we should have a legal system that recognises the standing of other species. It's all in the pronouns.
Thank you very much, Delphine. Thank you. And it's time for our second hymn, which is in the purple book, number 147, Spirit of Earth, Root, Stone and Tree. But the words will appear on the screen. Following on from the theme of that last hymn about spirit of life, I'd like to read a short piece called Spirits by the Reverend Cliff Reed. Those of you who know me know that I draw great inspiration from Cliff Reed's writings, and he very often writes on environmental matters, and this just seemed to fill the slot nicely. So Cliff Reed asks, are there spirits in the trees? Are there spirits in the streams? Are there spirits in the hills? Are there spirits all around us, wishing us well, awaiting our prayers, awaiting our offerings? Spirits to worship, spirits to fear. We thought so once, but not now, not really. Though poetry and myth remember them, ours is a universe without spirits. But we breathe life's breath. And so do all the myriad creatures among the crags, across the fens, out over the heaving seas. Out over the heaving seas is the whispering, howling wind, the breath of earth, the spirit of life. One breath, one spirit in all things. Filling dust with life, filling life with love. and God is spirit. And now Delphine is going to offer some more readings.
Sorry, apologies. It's not all my voice. I'm reading this time from Entangled Lives by Martin Sheldrake. It's about the kingdom of the fungi, the systems we don't often think very much about, but they're massively there in a very entangled way. And what the science that he brings to us just makes you go, oh my God. It does me anyway. So microbes in our bodies. We're thinking of the scale of this, this, and this. Microbes cover every inch of the planet. In the last four decades, new technologies have granted unprecedented success to microbial lives. And the outcome for your community of microbes, your biome, your body is a planet. Some microbes prefer the temperate forest of your forearm. Some the tropical forest of your crotch or armpit. Your gut, which if unfolded would occupy an area of 32 square meters, ears, toes, mouth, eyes, skin, and every surface, passage, and cavity you possess teem with bacteria or fungi. You carry around more microbes than your own cells. There are more bacteria in your gut than there are stars in our galaxy. For humans, identifying where one individual stops and another starts is not generally something we think about. It's usually taken for granted, with modern industrial societies, at least. Not with Robin Lee Kimmerer, obviously. That we start where our bodies begin and stop where our bodies end. Well, as you see, we are ecosystems ourselves, composed of and decomposed by an ecology of microbes, the significance of which is only now coming to light scientifically. The 40 trillion of microbes that live in and on our bodies allow us to digest food, produce key minerals that nourish us. Like the fungi that live within plants, they protect us from disease, they guide the development of our bodies and immune systems, they influence our behaviour. If not kept in check, they can cause illness, even kill us. We are not a special case. Even bacteria have viruses within them. A nanobiome? Symbiosis is a ubiquitous feature of life. We are alive. A poem that brings this and moves it with a spirit of joyful acceptance and welcome is from Jenny Cousin, a South African poet. This was written in the 1980s, before Entangled Lives was written, but her conception of it is very like. A prayer, as it is. There are some creatures living in my body. I bid them welcome. Let them feed off me as I off wild creatures that run free. Let my veins and bones be to them rivers and baobabs. Let cells be huge, rich valleys. Let gigantic landscapes roll and change as I flex my nerves. Oh, I wish them an excellent universe, such a one as I inhabit, mountains and wind and a lot of stars. Nor let them pollute and destroy what they find. Let my rivers of blood flow clean, my flesh be fertile and multiply, nor cloud with stale chemicals the clear, windows of my eyes.
Thank you so much for that reading, Delphine. And we thought it might be a good thing to include candles of joy and concern here. And you're welcome to light a candle and briefly express a concern or a joy, or in silence. So we're going to have a little silence to begin so that you can gather your thoughts. And then we're going to play a video of a gentle stream. And if you wish to come up and light a candle, please do. If anybody on Zoom wants to add anything, if you could let us know, Steve. Thank you. So for a moment, just a little silence to gather our thoughts. I just gone to the back to see if anyone on Zoom wished to send a message. And apparently Erna is on watching, which is lovely. So hello, Erna, and all Zoomers. Lovely to have you with us. And now Edgar is going to read for us.
So this is a poem by Margaret Atwood, The Moment. The moment when after many years of hard work and a long voyage, you stand in the center of your room, house, half acre, square mile, island, country, knowing at last how you got there and say, I own this, is the same moment when the trees unloose their soft arms from around you, the birds take back their language, the cliffs fissure and collapse, the air moves back from you like a wave, and you can't breathe. No, they whisper, you own nothing. You were a visitor, time after time, climbing the hill, planting the flag, proclaiming. We never belonged to you. You never found us. It was always the other way round. And then some words from the words of Hildegard of Bingen. I am that great and fiery force, which I believe can be found in the Purple Hymn book number 67. I am the great and fiery force, sparkling in everything that lives, in shining of the river's course, in greening grass that glory gives. I shine in glitter on the seas, in burning sun, in moon and stars, in unseen wind, in verdant trees, I breathe within, both near and far. And where I breathe, there is no death, and meadows glow with beauties rife. I am in all the spirit's breath, the thundered word, for I am life.
Thank you, Edgar. And the words of Hildegard were chosen by our own Kate. Delphine chose several wonderful readings, and she said she's happy for me to read this one, and it's called The Living Mountain by Nan Shepherd. The idea is being as an experience and an interaction of love. The book is taken from her account of getting to know by exploration, walking the Cairngorm Mountains, through the senses we have in love to an understanding through experiencing, which is mutual becoming, with so-called inanimate place, the mountain itself. So Nan writes, my journey into an experience began. It was a journey always for fun, with no motive beyond that I wanted it. But at first I was seeking only sensuous gratification, the sensation of height, the sensation of movement, the sensation of speed, the sensation of distance, the sensation of effort, the sensation of ease, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. I was not interested in the mountain for itself, but for its effect upon me, as puss caresses not the man, but herself against the man's trouser leg. But as I grew old and less self-sufficient, I began to discover the mountain in itself. Everything became good to me. Its contours, the colour, its waters and rock, flowers and birds. This process has taken many years and is not yet complete. Knowing another is endless. And I have discovered that man's experience of knowing them enlarges rock, flower and bird. The thing to be known grows with knowing. I believe that I now understand, in some small measure, why the Buddhist goes on pilgrimage to a mountain. The journey is itself part of the technique by which the God is sought. It is a journey into being. For as I penetrate more deeply into the mountain's life, I penetrate into my own. For an hour I am beyond desire. It is not ecstasy that leaps out of the self that makes man like a god. I am not out of myself, but in myself. I am to know. Being, this is the final grace accorded from the mountain. And it's time to sing again. This is the hymn number 183 in the Purple Book. We are daughters of the stars, and a little warning that there is no accompanying singing. There's piano and the words appear on the screen. So please sing up as much as you can. Everyone. And I'm pretty sure Kate chose that one with a twinkle in her eye. And mentioning Kate, who unfortunately can't be with us today, but she has written a piece, so I'm going to read it to you now, and it's called I Am Nature by our own Reverend Kate. There was a time when we humans wouldn't have been able to conceive of ourselves as being apart from nature. Throughout our long history as hunter-gatherers, we seemed as one with it all. But once we began to farm and put down roots, and particularly when we started to own land, which we then felt we had to defend, things changed. We began to have dominion, as the Bible puts it. At our best, we became stewards and collaborators. At our worst, exploiters. Even in our own lives as infants, we took time to learn that we were separate from our mothers and our surroundings. To return to unknowing, that unselfish, unself-conscious state of unison with nature, is probably impossible now. it feels like we left Eden. There was a moment, or more likely a gradual process, during which we lost innocence and realized we had the power and intelligence to control and manipulate our environment, for better or worse. At least up to a point. It is as though we ate the metaphorical apple and saw that we were different, that we had been given a different kind of agency from the rest of nature. There was no going back. And yet, underneath it all, we are still one. And finding ways to remember our at-oneness with nature is no different, surely, from seeking communion with the divine, with God, life, the universe. Of course, we celebrate the miracle of being fully human with all that entails. But within our humanity lies a deep yearning to experience ourselves in union with creation once more. We long for the relief of realizing we're not in charge, as we had thought, but merely a part of the great unfolding. This is part of our spiritual journey. Sometimes it takes a tragedy, an accident, a death, or a near miss to awaken us. Kate concludes by writing, I have never felt more helplessly part of nature than when I was ill with pneumonia or dragged out of my depth in the sea, or watching my mother die of a brain tumour. Nor more gloriously part of it than when standing on top of a snowy-capped mountain in the Dolomites, or drifting down the Zambezi at sunset. There are times when we wake up, and then, for an instant anyway, we know we are home. Thanks to Kate for writing that. We're going to have our final hymn and then a shared reading by the members of the Green Team who are present here today. So our final hymn is the Purple Hymn 216, Wild Green Word, We Know and Love You.
We are all your Lord, your Master. We rule and supreme is our star.
final reading, Steve isn't quite sure whether the camera will pick up from the lectern, so he's going to test it. It does, okay. Well, I'll read the introduction, and then if we each in turn like to come up to the lectern, and we hope it works. This is a shared reading, and it's written by Chief Dan George, who was born Geswanuth Shalhut. He was a chief of the Cecil Wachuth Nation, which was on an Indian reserve located in the southwest area of the district of North Vancouver in British Columbia in Canada. He was also an actor, a musician, poet and author. His best known written work is My Heart Soars. As an actor, he's best remembered for portraying old Lodgskins opposite Dustin Hoffman in Little Big Man, for which he was nominated for an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor, and also for his role in the outlaw Josie Wales as Lone Watty opposite Clint Eastwood. So a wonderful man of many parts. And he wrote this piece, which our green team is going to read.
The beauty of the trees, the softness of the air, the fragrance of the grass speaks to me.
The summit of the mountain, the thunder of the sky, the rhythms of the sea speak to me.
The faintness of the stars, the freshness of the morning, the dewdrop on the flower speak to me.
The strength of fire, the taste of salmon, the trail of the sun, and the life that never goes away, they speak to me, and my heart soars.
And some closing words written by Celia Cartwright, who some of you may remember started her Unitarian career in Torquay Church. So Celia writes, "Let us go in peace, to live together in harmony, to see beauty in everything, to know wonder in each passing moment, and to walk gently with our God. Amen."